Well, let's do this. Before we get into the word, Lord, let's go before God in prayer. Amen. Father, we thank you for today, Lord, and we just ask that your Holy Spirit would be amongst us today to teach us and to lead us and to guide us. God, we don't come into this place to hear from a man, to hear from a woman, from the older, from the young, but Lord, we come to hear from you. And we ask today that as we open up your word, Lord, that it would be you that speaks to us out of your word, that leads us and guides us and directs us. Lord, I thank you that you would help us to open up our eyes, to see our ears, to hear our hearts, to understand your word, your will, your ways for our lives, God. As we take these and we apply them, Lord, I thank you that your blessings and your grace and your favor would be upon us everywhere we go. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us in this place, and Lord, that you continue to do. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all together said, amen. Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles, I want you to go with me to the book of Haggai, chapter 1. And you're like, Pastor Luke, where's Haggai? It's real easy to find, okay? Open up to the very beginning of your Bible. It's called Concordance, and you'll find it right in there. And then it'll tell you the page number where it's at. Otherwise, just go to the book of Matthew, turn a couple pages over to the Old Testament. You'll find it. Or if you've got a tablet or a modern device, it's very simple. Look for the book that starts with an H. All right. Today we're going to talk about looking at what we've been talking about. We're in this new series called Breathing Room. And Breathing Room is God's idea, God's plan for financial stewardship in our lives. You say, oh man, you guys are going to talk about money. Yes. Here's why. Just a little recap of what we talked about last week. In the New Testament, you will find 215 verses pertaining to your faith. In the New Testament, you'll find 218 verses pertaining to your salvation. But yet, in the New Testament, you will find 2,083 verses that regard or deal with the subject of finances, money, or the accountability of your resources. And so, we can see with that it's important for God that we get a hold and we get an idea of what God wants to do and God wants to say in our lives. To take it one step further, two-thirds of all of the parables, the stories that Jesus told had to do with or dealt with money. So it's a very important subject for us, and what we're going to talk about today is God's idea, God's ways, and God's financial systems for our lives. Looking at last week, if you didn't hear last week, I want to encourage you can download our new app. We're soft launching, it's called. That's why we're not pushing it yet. So you can go on the App Store and download it for free, or you can go on your Android store and download it. You can watch the message online on the app, on the computer, or you can go and get a CD. But I encourage you to grab a hold of it, because these two messages particularly are the foundational work for the rest of the series that we're talking about. And so last week, we talked about renouncing the spirit of mammon. Now, what does that mean, the spirit of mammon? We learned that all money in itself is not inherently evil. Money is innate. Money is just money. But we learned that all money has a spirit that rests upon it. It's either the spirit of God, or it's the spirit of mammon, or we call it the spirit of the world. The spirit of the world that says, I can do this on my own. I don't need God. And so Jesus says you can only serve one master. You can't serve God and mammon, the spirit of the world. You have to choose who will you serve. So we talked about renouncing the influence and the spirit of mammon in our lives. And how to renounce the spirit of mammon is simply this, is to recognize that God is my source for all things in my life. And when we recognize that God is our source, we are renouncing the spirit of mammon. You see, your job, your employer, your income, your retirement, your social security, your spouse, that's not your provision. God is your provider. The place in where you get provision is the place that God has brought you to for a place of provision, as we learned with Elijah and the widow. So we recognize that our provision doesn't come from our job, therefore we're not loyal to that with our hearts. We're loyal to God because God is the source of our provision, and that's breaking the very spirit of mammon. In talking about that, we learn that there are two economic systems in this world. The economic system that we live by is to buy and to sell. When you buy something, you want it, you get it for you, or you sell something. You say, Pastor Luke, I'm not a market, I don't sell, I only buy, I'm a consumer. As a matter of fact, if you have a job, you are selling something. Your employer is buying your time, your talent, your resources, and you are giving of that time for a price. You're selling your services. So we live in an economic system of buying and selling, the world. But we saw briefly last week, and we're going to focus on that today, that there's another economic system, and that's God's system, and that is to give and receive. Now, last week when we talked about this, we talked about the spirit of influence and the influence of mammon on our lives, and that we focus on value. And the value that we even put on God's kingdom is the give and I want it back, to give and receive. If I give, it's because I want something in return. And so like Pastor Dan talked about just a couple of minutes ago, we saw in the Word of God that when we give and we expect nothing in return, what we are doing is we are introducing and relying on God's grace in our finances. We've heard grace defined here at the Rock Church like this. Pastor Jim says it like this. God's sovereign divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. Grace is God's unmerited favor, some might say. I need God's ability in my finances because I can't seem to do it on my own. And I need God's grace in that system of my life. And so today we're going to talk about God's financial systems and how we live and how we operate in that. And how we ought to keep our eyes and our mindset focused on God as the source of our provision. Now I had you turn to Haggai in the first chapter. Haggai is a very small book, very easy to miss in the Old Testament. Right before the New, right before the New Testament, there is the book of Haggai. And Haggai is only two chapters long, very short. But here I want to show you something about what God has to say. Haggai, in the first chapter, verse number 6. Here's God speaking to his people. And look what God says in verse number 6. God says this. He says, "You have sown much and you bring in little. You eat, but you don't have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put them in a bag with holes in it." It's kind of funny because I read that and I think, God, how did you know me so well thousands of years ago? Because doesn't that verse so accurately paint a picture of our culture? It's like, we've all been there. We talked about this last week. We've all been there. We've all just said, God, if I could just get a little bit more, I'll be okay. If you could just give me a little bit more, I won't ask for anything ever again. I'll be good, right? And then we get a little bit more, and what happens? God, I just need a little bit more than that little bit more. And it keeps growing, and it keeps going, right? We never seem to have enough. It seems like, you know, when we try to eat, we consume, and it's like we're never hungry, or we're never full enough. He says, you drink and you're never full enough. It's like you clothe yourselves and you're never warm enough. It's like just when you seem to get on one fashion trend, you say, okay, I'm in it with the times, right? All of a sudden you go in and everybody's wearing something different. You just can't keep up. And then he goes and he says, and you work so hard, and you put all your money into a bag, and what does it feel like? It feels like that bag has holes in it. I think Haggai chapter 1, verse number 6, is the great illustration and the great picture of our culture and our society today. That is painting the picture of our times. As a matter of fact, if there's something that paints the picture of our times, I would say the modern day picture of our culture is called a meme. And I think one of the best memes that are out there, some of the best memes that are out there, are money memes. Payday memes. I thought I'd show you just a couple of them. And I just wanted to point out my very favorite one right here is the squirrel. Must make it until payday. I think sometimes these memes are funny. We laugh about them, but they're so true. I mean, you got Iron Man, you got Robert Downey Jr., Tony Stark, one day on payday, and it's like, I have arrived. Praise the Lord, right? And then the rest of the month, it's like struggling, you know, trying to make ends meet. I love the one on top right there. It says, almost payday. And it's two pieces of bread with ice cubes because that's all you can afford to eat. Or the little boy in the middle, he's contorting himself, and it says, me when it's Friday and it's payday. That's right. I like the little boy right there. I survived until next paycheck. You see, we have this idea. We understand this. We can relate to this because in some form or fashion, we've all felt exactly what Haggai is saying, what God is saying to his people in this area. He says, you eat, you're not full. You drink, and it's not enough. You make money, but it's not enough. And it seems like whatever you have, you put it into a bag, and it seems like there's holes in the bag. And I say, amen, God, you know me so well that you wrote it thousands of years ago. And I think what we want to look at today, when we look at God's financial systems for our lives, is I want to show you the wisdom of God and the words of God in the very next verse of what God was saying. In Haggai chapter 1, verse number 7, it says it like this. It says, thus say the Lord God of hosts. Now, when it says, thus says the Lord God of hosts, you know you ought to be listening. I'm just saying, right? He says to the people, consider your ways. I think it's the New International Version that says, think carefully about what you're doing. God says, listen, you don't have enough. You're never hungry. You're never full enough. You don't have enough. It's like you're putting your money into a bag of holes. And God says, think about what you're doing. Interesting.
I think about that for a moment. I think about how often do we really focus on what's important in our lives? How often do we really consider our ways? Because you see, God wants us to live something a little bit different than the ways of the world. We saw that there's a world economic system, and now we see that there's a kingdom economic system, the dynamics of the kingdom. And God says it like this in Isaiah. God says to his people, he says, listen, my thoughts are not your thoughts. He says, my ways are not your ways. He goes on, he says, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts, and my ways are higher than your ways. You see, God doesn't want you to live according to your ways. God wants you to live according to his ways. The psalmist says it like this, teach me your ways, O Lord, that I would walk in your truth, not my understanding, not my mental capacity. Teach me, God, your ways, that I would walk in your truth. You see, God wants us to walk not in our ways, but in his ways. As a matter of fact, Jesus says it like this. Jesus said that he is the way, the truth, and the life. You see, nobody goes to the Father, he says, except through him. You see, so God wants us not to live life according to our ways, but God wants us to live life according to his ways. Now, we do this. We get this idea. We get this understanding. We say, God, I'm going to live according to your ways when it comes to my faith. God, I'm going to live according to your ways when it comes to my healing. God, I'm going to live according to your ways when it comes to my relationships and when it comes to the things of the world. I'm going to cast those aside and live according to your ways. But God, when it comes to finances, well, and we leave it at that. You see, that's why God gave us 2,083 verses in the Bible. And as a matter of fact, when it comes to talking about things in the Bible, we only need a verse or two to talk about faith. Amen. Praise the Lord. We only need a verse or two to talk about healing. Praise the Lord. Amen. I believe it. I receive it in Jesus' name. But when it comes to finances, we're like that picture in that meme. Like, I need to see all 2,083 verses to confirm this is the word of the Lord. Well, today I want to take you to some of those verses today. If you've got your Bibles, we're going to go through a lot of them just because I really want you to understand we're teaching the Word and not some opinions. Go with me to Matthew in the 6 chapters. What are God's ways? If God says my ways are different, if God says my thoughts are higher, if they're different than us, and the psalmist says, teach me these ways and not my own, what are the ways of God? Well, we started talking about that last week in this Breathing Room series. And today I want to take you back to Matthew the 6th chapter. We were there last week looking at a little bit of verses past this, but we're going to look today at verse number 19 through 21. Matthew chapter 6, verse number 19, Jesus says these words. He says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. So he says, don't store up, don't build up, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. Now, so often what we say is, well, Jesus is saying we don't need to be treasure builders. We'll see in just a moment that that's not the case at all. Jesus goes on in verse number 20 and he says, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves break in or steal. And he says it like this, and the reason why he says this statement is this very important reason right here. He says, because for where your treasure is, your heart will be also. And you see, Jesus told us last week, as we saw this in the book of Matthew, Jesus says you cannot, not you should not, he says you cannot serve God and mammon. You cannot serve the Spirit of God and the Spirit of the world. They do not work together. It's one or the other. He said it so starkly. He said, you will love one and hate the other, or you will be loyal to one and despise the other. It does not work together. And so Jesus says, do not lay up for yourselves earthly treasures. Why? Because they're not secure. We think they're secure. I mean, think about it. We put our money into a bank account. Why? Because it's supposed to be safe, right? The FDIC or the NCIU or whatever it is, those are supposed to ensure the fact that our money, our treasures stay safe. But we've all seen it. We've seen what happens to financial systems across the world. They come and they go. Jesus says the world's treasures, moth will eat, rust will destroy, thieves will come and steal and take away from us. But he says, lay up for yourselves treasures, not in earth, but in heaven, in my system, in my economic system. And he says, moth won't destroy it. He says, thieves won't steal it. Rust won't take it away. It will build on your behalf. And the reason it's so important to understand this is because Jesus says this, because where your treasure is, your heart lies also. Did you know that God hardwired your heart to be loyal to your treasure? To be loyal to your security? To be loyal to the source of your provision? God hardwired that into you. It's ingrained in your system. Why? Because when God created Adam and Eve, they were completely united to God. There was no separation.
They relied completely on God. They had no idea of the things around them. And God said, everything I have is yours, except don't touch that tree in the middle of the garden. We know the story. Sin came, and sin took our eyes off of our source of provision, God, and it fixed it around the world. And now all of a sudden, Adam and Eve became realized that they were naked. They realized that they didn't have enough, and so they started to clothe themselves. They started to do different things. Why? Because God hardwired our heart originally to be loyal to Him. And so Jesus says, whatever your security is, whatever your treasure is, whatever it is that you're banking on, whatever it is that you're holding on, whatever it is that your identity is wrapped up in, whether it's the economic systems of the world, whether it's the valuation of the stock market, whether it's your retirement fund, whether it's your job or your social security, whether it's your spouse or whatever it might be, Jesus says, wherever your treasure is, whatever that is that you're loyal to, He says, that's where your heart will be also. And so He doesn't want us, this dual idea of a heart loyal to here and a heart loyal to there. And can I bring it to you? Can I lay something kind of heavy on you? Are you all right? I know it's 11, 12 o'clock now, so it's lunchtime. But let me just say it like this. In essence, loyalty to any security outside of God is idolatry. Loyalty to any security outside of God is idolatry. Because Jesus says, wherever your security is, wherever your treasure is, wherever you're wrapped up in, that's exactly where your heart's going to be. And Jesus says, you'll either love one or you'll hate the other. And if your loyalty, your security, your treasure's not wrapped up in God, guess what? It's wrapped up somewhere else, and it's taken the place that God designed to be in, number one, in your life. Thus He said, you shall have no other gods before Me. And so we realize how important it is for us to live according to the ways of God. According to God's ways, Jesus says, don't wrap it up in earthly treasures. Wrap it up in heavenly treasures. Pastor Luke, I get it. I want heavenly treasure, but I have earthly bills. Amen. Go with me. Let's look at this. Let's go a little bit further. If you got your book, you're in Matthew. Turn a couple pages over to Mark. Mark in the 10th chapter. There's a story, as you're turning to Mark in the 10th chapter, I'll just share it with you. There's a rich young ruler that comes to Jesus, and he says to Jesus these words, he says, good teacher. Now, you got to understand, when somebody comes in the Jewish culture, and they say to somebody, they call them a good teacher, they're not just saying, hey man, I recognize that you're a really good, you're a great communicator. No, he says, I'm positioning myself under your authority and your subjection. When he recognizes and he acknowledges Jesus as a good teacher, he says, Jesus, what he's saying to Jesus is, whatever you have to say to me, I'm recognizing and accepting the fact that I'm going to accept that as truth. Jesus says, well, why do you call me good but God? There's none good but God. And he says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus gives him 6 of the 10 commandments. And he says, you got to do all these things. And the young ruler comes to Jesus and he says, well, I've done all of these from my youth. What do I still need to do? And Jesus, look what it says. Now, this is where I want to focus today. Jesus, in verse number 21, it says this, Jesus looking at him, loved him. Jesus looking at him, loved him. Now, we know the story. We know that he's tied up in his possessions. He's called the rich young ruler for a reason. Why? Because he's got a lot of stuff. Jesus knew exactly where his loyalty was. Jesus knew exactly where his treasure was. But I love how it says, Jesus didn't look at him in spite. Jesus didn't look at him in malice. Jesus didn't look at him in frustration. It said, Jesus looked at him and he loved him. He says, listen, I love you enough to tell you the truth of where you're at. Your heart is committed somewhere else. And so Jesus looked at him and he loved him. Verse number 21. And he says to him, one thing you lack. Man, how true is that? God, I'll give you my heart and my faith. God, I'll give you my heart with my kids. God, I'll give you my heart with my relationships. God, I'll give you my heart with what I watch on TV. But God, when it comes to money, woo, I'm just not quite so sure yet. One thing you lack, Jesus says. He says, go your way and sell whatever you have and give the money to the poor and you will have treasures in heaven. And pick up the cross and come and follow me. Think about that for a moment. Jesus knew exactly where this rich young ruler was. Why? He was wrapped up in his possessions. As a matter of fact, we know this. Why? Because the very next verse tells us, verse number 22 says that he went away sorrowful, sad. Why? Because he had great possessions. You see, Jesus looked at him and he acknowledged, he understood this man was under the influence of mammon, under the influence of the world, under the influence and the identity of all of the things that he had. That was the security system in which he lived his life. And Jesus says, you are under the influence of mammon, and if you want to do that, you want to profane the spirit of mammon, get rid of the influence by selling what you have, converting your wealth into money, and taking your money and give it to the poor. Now, you got to understand what Jesus was saying, because we look at that and say, man, that's a hard pill to swallow. Sell everything. Pastor Luke, are you going to preach the rest of this message about selling everything I have and giving it to the poor? Because if so, I really wish I would have not come today. Listen, that's not what I'm going to talk about today. Praise God. You can take a big, deep breath. But that's between you and God. But here's what Jesus said. Contextually, Jesus said, take your wealth, convert it to money, give your money to the poor. The Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs that giving to the poor is lending to the Lord. That's a financial investment I want to get involved in. I don't know about you, but I've lent to people before and they didn't show back up when it was time to return the favor, right? So Jesus is telling him what's already in the scriptures. Giving to the poor is lending to the Lord. And he doesn't just say, hey, give it to the poor, I'm going to make you broke and someday in heaven you'll get it all back and have that. He says, give to the poor and follow me and you will have heavenly treasures. You see, this man was wrapped up in treasures. God understands us. God understood humanity. He built on the inside of us an incentive system. He says, listen, I know you guys like rewards, so I'm going to build it into your lives. God, Jesus says, I will give you an incentive. Get rid of your earthly treasure, and I'll give you a heavenly treasure. Your earthly treasure, it's going to demean. If the market crashes, it's gone. If thieves steal it, you don't get it back. Your heavenly treasure is not based on the valuation of men. Your heavenly treasure is not based on what the Federal Reserve's interest rate is. Your heavenly treasure is based on God. Pastor Luke, that's so wonderful. It's so good. I want heavenly treasures, but still, I have earthly needs. How does heavenly treasures help me today? Let's talk about that. Let's talk about living and operating in God's economic system of give and receive. This is God's system of working, His ways. Now, Jesus, or we saw this, God said it like this in Isaiah, my ways are not your ways, my thoughts are not your thoughts. He says it like this, my ways are higher and my thoughts are higher. Oftentimes when we grasp a hold of something that's a little bit higher than us, it's really hard and complex. And thus Jesus came, and what did he do? He gave us analogies. He gave us stories. He showed us a likeness, something that we could understand simply. So I want to tell you, as we look into God's economic system, I want to give you an analogy. I want to tell you, we'll explain it in terms that we all understand. So it's very important, if you've tuned me out because I'm talking about money, tune me back in just really quickly so at the back door, you don't say that I said something I didn't say, okay? Then whatever. So here's what we're going to do. Well, I'm going to talk about God's economic system, but I'm going to use the analogy of something that we understand today to explain something that is higher and than our thoughts and higher than our ways. Do y'all understand that? Okay? This is an analogy. It's a likeness of. Okay, now if you were tuning me out, you want to go back to it? Whatever. You got that. Let's talk about God's economic systems and let's explain it in a way we all understand it. And let's explain it like this. Banking. We all understand banking. Why? Because you take your money and you deposit it into a bank account, right? And there it sits in a bank account. And what does it do? It sits in that bank account, and then when you need it, what do? You go to the bank, and you withdraw that money from your bank account. Why? To use it for your needs. So we understand, it's called a system of debits and credits, or credits and debits. When you have a cash account, when you deposit into your cash account, you are debiting or adding to the value of that account. When you go to the bank and you withdraw from your cash account, what are you doing? You are crediting that account, or you are withdrawing or devaluing the cash value of that account. We understand that. So what we do is we debit our accounts and we put it into a bank. Why? So that it would grow, so that it would earn interest, so that it would save it for a rainy day or for a need. And so we put it into that savings account for the time that we need it. And what happens? It earns interest and it makes money for us, right? I mean, I think last year in my savings account, it was so exciting when I got that little 1099 interest from the bank. I think I made 75 cents. Right? Because it's like 0.002% interest return on your money. I mean, it's amazing. You got to have like $100 million to make 10. But you see, it's the same system, the same idea with God's system. When we give, what we are doing is we are depositing into our heavenly account. There, God takes our heavenly deposit, and God is our financial manager. He's not a CPA. He's not somebody who's got good advice for what the market trends are. God says, I am the creator of the universe. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning from the end. I know all things at all times at all places. So God takes our deposit, our debit to our account, and He begins to multiply it with His mathematics. Don't you know God's mathematics are way better than the Fed's mathematics? Jesus talks about it. He says, you'll sow a seed, some will return 30, 60, or 100-fold of that return. And so God puts our heavenly account, we deposit into our heavenly account by giving without expectation of return, and God becomes our manager of our heavenly account, and things start to work on our behalf. Let's talk about this heavenly account. Let's talk about this credit and debit system. You're in Mark. Go with me now. We were here last week, but let's go again. You still with me? All right. Go with me to 1 Timothy chapter 6. We were here last week. Paul was exhorting his protege, his young pastor, Timothy, to exhort his congregation. In 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter, Paul exhorts Timothy to exhort his congregation thus. Verse number 17. He says, command those who are rich in the present age. Command those who are affluent. Command those who have money. Command those who have resources and the means to an end. He says, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty or prideful, not to trust and listen to this uncertain riches. Remember, Jesus said, your earthly treasures, moth and rust will destroy, thieves will steal. So he says, command them not to trust in uncertain riches, but to do what with them? But to trust in God. We talked about this last week, to announce and to pronounce and to proclaim that God is the source of my provision. Trust in God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Here's why, verse number 18, let them, listen to this, do good, that they would be rich, not in money, but in good works. Listen to this, ready to give, willing to share. Oh, wait a minute, be unselfish with my assets? Who would have thought? Why, verse number 19, storing up for themselves. Jesus said, don't lay up for yourselves. Don't store up for yourselves. Don't build up for yourselves. So he says, listen, tell them to not be confident in the world system and their riches that they have because it's uncertain. He says, but tell them to do good works, that they would be rich in good works. Tell them to be willing to give, ready to give, and willing to share. Why? So that they would start building up, storing up, laying up for themselves heavenly treasure. He says, look at this. Storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold of eternal life. You see, depositing into God's kingdom, giving and living according to God's economic system, starts putting our heart at rest. That's when Jesus says, don't worry. Don't worry about what you'll eat. Don't worry about what you'll drink. Don't worry about what you'll wear. You see, Jesus says these are the Gentile worries. Why the outsider worries? Because when we start depositing into our heavenly account, it removes the burden of worry from our hearts. Why? Because we know that our system is not based on uncertain riches. Rather, our lives are based on the economic system of God, which will never fade away. The Bible says that the wealth of the world or the wicked is stored up for the righteous. God has a plan for you, and He wants you to live according to that, so that your heart could be free of worry from your financial systems. All right, I'm still building this up, so let's go now to Philippians. Go with me to Philippians in the 4th chapter. You guys still with me? All right, keep with me. We're still there. You're saying, Pastor Luke, how do heavenly treasures help me on earthly needs? We're going to get there, I promise. Philippians in the 4th chapter, Paul has some great statements. I mean, I love Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And Philippians, in the end of Philippians, the 4th chapter, there's a scripture that we oftentimes quote when it comes to money and resources, and we believe it. It's a faith profession that we say. As a matter of fact, when we used to do our offering profession, that was the end of our offering profession, was this verse. But I want to show you the context of what Paul the Apostle is talking to the church at Philippi. I want to start in verse number 14. Right after Paul says, I can do all things through Christ, Paul says this, nevertheless, why? Because there's more to it than this. Nevertheless, you have done well that you have shared. Remember, he said, be willing to share? That you have shared in my distress. Now, you Philippians also know that in the beginning, the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, only you. Paul says, listen, when I was starting out, when I left Macedonia, when I left modern-day Greece, he says, nobody was helping me out except you. Now, as we know contextually, the Philippian church, the Macedonian church, was not a rich church in this area, but rather they gave out of their poverty to the word of God, to Paul. And he says that you were the ones that shared with me. Verse number 16, he says, for even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. You sent me resources so that I can continue to do the work of God. Verse number 17, and he says it like this. Look at this. He says, not that I seek your gift. Paul says, I'm not writing you because I'm looking for your money. Not that I seek your gift. Paul says, but I seek the fruit that abounds. Now, I love that word, abounds. Dad used to describe it like this. Abounds is like a big dog running at you at full speed. It's not going to stop. Paul says, I'm looking for this gift, this fruit that's coming at you like a locomotive, coming your way. Hey, you ain't going to stop it. He says, I'm looking for the fruit that abounds to what? Your account. I like that. You see, when we give at the leading of God, what we are doing is we are opening up a debit and credit account in giving and receiving. Giving at the leading of God opens up a debit and credit account in the heavenly system of giving and receiving. Now, I say giving at the leading of God. Why? Because we give oftentimes out of guilt. We give out of shame. We give out of condemnation. We give out of coercion. And it's not about that. Paul says, you gave for me from what you had. You were an example to the other churches. You gave because God led you. And when God led you, all of a sudden now you began to open up an account of debits and credits in your heavenly treasures. And I love now we come to the verse that we always quote. Verse number 18, Paul says it like this. Paul says, indeed, I have all and I abound and I'm full, having received from Epaphroditus the things that was sent from you. And I love it, like he says, what you sent was a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice to the Lord. Why? Because living in God's economic system is not easy to our worldly ideas. It's a sacrifice. But I love how he follows up with verse number 19, in the verse that we always quote with our finances. And he says, and my God shall supply all of your needs according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. I love that. He says, my God shall supply all your needs according to the federal income or the Federal Reserve's income rate. No, my God shall supply all your needs based on the median return of stock market investments. No, my God shall supply all your needs based on the growth of the market. No, my God shall supply all your needs based on the equity of your home. No, my God, he says, shall supply all your needs according to His riches and glory, His financial economic system for your life. You open up a debit and credit account in your heavenly treasures. God is your money manager, and He takes it like Jesus with the loaves, and He takes what you've deposited, and you start collecting interest. Now remember, I'm using worldly terms for a heavenly concept. You start collecting interest in heaven, and God says, I got more than enough to take care of your needs here on earth. Pastor Luke, that's great. You got me pumped. But I still got a bill due. And I don't got the money in my bank account. Like that meme that said, I looked at my bank account and I didn't know whether I should laugh or I should cry. That's how I still feel. So I'm glad about heavenly treasures, but I still have earthly needs. And so let me get to the question everybody's asking anyways. And that is, how do I withdraw? We all want to know, how do I get it? Well, in order to understand how we withdraw, we have to go back to the very beginning when we talked about God said, my ways aren't your ways. My thoughts aren't your thoughts. And so when we use this worldly analogy of banking, we understand what would happen. Well, we deposit and we withdraw. Why? When we need it, right? I need to pay a bill. I need to buy lunch. I need to do something. So I go to the bank and I withdraw. Now I get to use my debit card and it automatically withdraws based on my need. So we think because of our system, well, I need to go to God and give to God my needs, but we got to understand, and this is heavy, all right? You ready for this? Just brace yourselves. We go to God thinking, God, I'm going to tell you my needs, but God does not respond and God is not moved by your needs. God responds to your faith. A faith clap, it's good. You'll get it. God doesn't respond to need. God knows your needs. As a matter of fact, Jesus talks about it. He says, when you pray, Jesus says, listen, God knows your needs before you even know your needs. Well, but Pastor Luke, God doesn't know my needs how I know my needs. No, that's right. God knows your needs how you should know your needs. All right. It's quiet in this Presbyterian church this morning. You're like, Pastor Luke, you're preaching hard. That's right. I'm working on it. God doesn't respond to our need. God responds to our faith. Why? There's enough need in the world to go around. God responds to our faith. As a matter of fact, we were looking at this last week when we talked about Elijah and the widow. Remember the story of Elijah and the widow? Elijah was there in the creek. He was getting resources from the creek, and the ravens came and they gave him bread and meat, and then all of a sudden that place of provision dried up, and God said, I'm going to send you to a widow. So what happens? We know the story. Elijah goes to the widow and he says, listen, I'm a little bit hungry. I've been getting fed by birds. I know it sounds crazy, but could you make me some food? And she said, what did she say to Elijah? She said, well, I've only got enough to make one more meal, and I was just planning on making that meal for me and my son, and then we were going to just die. I'm like, wait a minute, what? You see, God knew her need. She already had a need. God wasn't moved by her needs. It was when she made Elijah the first of that meal, when she gave Elijah the bread, when she gave Elijah what Elijah said. God says to you, if you listen to me, he will respond to you. She acted in faith, and now all of a sudden, the Bible tells us in that story, right, that her flour and her oil did not dry up until the drought was over. God wasn't moved by her needs. He was moved by her faith. Which is exactly why last week we talked about this. Guys, listen, listen, listen. God's not after your money. God's after your faith. He wants your faith, your belief, your heart connected to Him and Him alone. And He will provide the rest. He knows what you need already. Oh, well, that's good. All right. Look what the Bible says in Mark the 11th chapter. I love Mark the 11th chapter, verse number 23. Oh, it's like the Bible verse of Bible verses, right? Jesus says this. He says, if any of you say to this mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea. Oh, man, that's a cool verse, right? I just picture it's like using the force, like boom, just dropping it, right? And does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things that he says will be done. He will have whatever he says. Why? Verse number 24 says it like this. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Your needs don't move God. Why? Because there are 7 billion other people on earth that have needs. And a lot of them have more needs than we do. But your faith moves God. Your faith moves God. Now all of a sudden God says, and he responds, and he says, wait a minute, they're stepping out in faith. Okay, God says, I'm going to lead you to give. And because you're giving, you're depositing. And now all of a sudden as you walk in faith, I see that there's a need. And God says, I'm going to provide. And so all of a sudden we start saying, God, I need money. I think society, I think culture, I think daytime TV has a great indication of how we live and how we think. I remember growing up back in the day, before we had DVRs, before you had YouTube, before you had the internet, when you just had a TV and you had to turn the knob, right, on channel 11 during the daytime, what was it? It was I Love Lucy all day long. And on channel 9, it was Maury Povich. And on channel 7, it was Days of Our Lives and all those other ones, right? Okay, I'm not even going to get into that. But during daytime TV, there's a commercial, it still goes on today. The guy sticks his head out the window, right? And he says, it's my money and I need it now, right? And then the guy comes out at the end of the commercial and says, it's your money, use it when you need it. You see, that's our economic system. God, we say, God, it's my heavenly treasure account and I need it now. But God says, that's not what moves me. That's not what moves me. What moves me is when you step out in faith and you trust me to provide for you how I see fit. Because like we talked about last week, if God is our source of provision, then money is my servant to build his kingdom. But if money is my source, God will not be my slave to get me more. God is moved by our faith. God is moved by our faith. But Pastor Luke, I ask, and he doesn't, and it doesn't come. I've even said, thank you, Lord, for money coming. And thanking God in a prayer is acting in faith, right? James chapter 4, verse number 3 kind of tells us a little bit about that. Kind of the very opposition to Mark, the 11th chapter. James says it like this. He says, you ask and you do not receive. But Jesus says you ask and you will receive. So he gives you the antithesis as to why it doesn't happen. You ask and you don't get it. Why? Because you're asking amiss. Why? So that you may spend it on your pleasures. Oh. Okay. You see, it's not about my needs. God knows my needs. It's about my faith. Is my faith in God as my source of provision? Is my faith that God will release, that God will grant me out of my heavenly bank account that I have been depositing as I give to God, at the, give at the leading of God? And will I stand in faith and walk in faith that when I need it, God knows the very time and the very season of my life in which He will provide me with that which I need? I love what Galatians says in the 6th chapter, verse number 9. Galatians says it like this. He says, "My brethren, don't grow weary while doing good." Why? "For in due season," he says, "you will reap if you do not lose heart." You see, every seed germinates at different rates. Sometimes a harvest comes quickly, sometimes a harvest comes slow. But God says, in your season, in your set time, in your due season, you will reap if you do not lose heart. God says, I've got a plan for you, and I'm asking you to step out in faith and trust that I am your provider, and I will give and grant from your heavenly treasures, from your heavenly account, what you need when you need it. The release from our heavenly account is on the basis of faith. That's how we do it. It's not an ATM machine. You thought, might have thought, well, Pastor, look, I came to the church and I thought those things in the back were ATM machines that I could withdraw from my heavenly account. No, those are the opposite. Those are deposit machines. So God gives us, He grants us, He provides for us on the basis of faith. Now let's talk about this, because the question is, and we'll finish on this, how then does God provide for us? How does it come? How does money cometh? How does it come? Well, the Bible shows us in a couple of different ways. Three different ways, as a matter of fact. The Bible shows us, and we'll use the story of the children of Israel, the Exodus, in the Promised Land. God shows us three different ways in which He provides for His people. Three different ways in which God provides. Here they are. Number one, God provides manna. Manna provision. Manna provision is the fun one. I like manna provision. Manna provision is when you're walking to the mailbox, and there ain't nothing in your bank account. And all of a sudden, you open up the mailbox and there is a check in the mail. And you're like, amen. Manna provision, right? When they were in the wilderness, there was no resource in sight. God brought them bread. When Elijah was there, God sent crows to feed him bread and meat. When Jesus was there with the crowd with not enough food, Jesus took the bread and He broke it, and God provided manna provision, and He multiplied it miraculously to provide for those who need. Manna is the fun one. I think the second fun one is harvest provision. When the children of Israel came out of the wilderness and they went into the land which God had promised them, God said, I'm commanding you, I want you to take this harvest. The people who inhabited this land before you, they sowed the seed, but you'll reap the harvest. And so what happens is God gives us a harvest provision. Somebody else sowed the seed and you get to reap the harvest. That's like when you get an inheritance or when somebody gives you a gift. That's their own harvest, but they are giving it, or you are reaping the benefits of their harvest. I like it. A couple of months ago, I was walking in the parking lot at a dealership and I found a $20 bill. Somebody sowed the seed. Praise God. I reap the harvest. The third way God provides, the way that we don't always like, but it's probably the most frequent way that God provides, is the sowing provision. There's the manna provision, there's the harvest provision, and now there's the sowing provision. Right after they reap that harvest, God commanded the children of Israel, I want you to sow a seed. I want you to plant for next harvest and plan. The Bible tells us, just like the laws of gravity, Jesus says it like this, or the Word of God says it like this, for what you sow, you shall reap. Just like gravity says, what goes up must come down. You cannot break that law on earth. God says, what you sow, you shall reap. And so when you start sowing in, when you start working, when you start putting your hands to work, when you start putting your mind to work, when you start using the gifts of intellect and knowledge that God has given to you for the benefit of the kingdom of God, you are sowing a seed into the ground, and that seed will produce a harvest if you don't lose heart. It's a law, an economic law that cannot be broken. What you sow, you will reap. And so God provides to us miraculously. God provides to us through others, and God provides to us through our own efforts. Manna provision, harvest provision, and sowing provision. And today as we conclude, and as we think about this, and as we walk out of this place, you say, man, Pastor Luke, that was a whole lot to bite off. This is just the introduction of the series. Last week we talked about renouncing the spirit of mammon in our lives. Is to recognize that God is our source of provision. That's the confession of faith. But don't you know, when it comes to faith, we can't just have faith with words. James tells us that we have to have works as well. And so the confession of our faith is recognizing and saying, God, I believe, and God, I confess, and God, I speak over my life that mammon will not have influence over my resources. But now all of a sudden, we got to put work, action to our faith. And that's starting to step in and live in God's economic system of giving and receiving and the leading of God. You see, God wants you to go. God wants you to live. Now you're saying, Pastor Luke, wait a minute. Does that mean, hey, I don't got to live to the world system anymore? No. Jesus told his disciples, you are in this world, but you are not of this world. Which means you can't walk out of this place and be like, well, I'm not buying and selling no more. When I need bread, I'm just going to go take it and believe that it's God, that the manna provision. Well, the supermarket owner is going to contest that that's not manna provision. Because you are still in this world. But even though we are in this world, we don't live according to this world. So that we might have to live according to the buy and sell systems of our world. Our faith is not in that system. Our faith in our heart is built and dwelt upon God's system of giving and receiving at the leading of God. And when we give without expectation of return, God's grace comes upon our financial system. And when we give into God's kingdom, we are literally opening up that debit and credit account of our heavenly treasures. And so when we act, when we step and we operate in faith, God says, I have been building this on your behalf. It's your retirement account for the eternal life. And I've got some stuff for you, but you need some right now. I got you, and I will grant you from your heavenly account. God says he will take care of you. So thus when Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. All these things are what? What shall I eat? What shall I wear? What shall I drink? Jesus says that's Gentile. That's outsider worries. Why? Because you're not on that world. You're not in the world anymore or of the world anymore. He says, no, you seek after me and all in my righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. The confession of our faith, paired with the works of our faith, of stepping out, giving of our resources, giving of our time, how about that? Giving of our talents, giving of our abilities, giving of our finances at the leading of God, opens up a debit and credit account to giving and receiving in God's economic system. And God begins to take credit for what we do in our life. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that your word challenges us, Lord, that your word corrects us, Lord, that your word steers us in the right direction. Like the psalmist said, teach me your ways that I would walk in your truth. Lord, I pray that as we look at your word today, Lord, as we looked at so many scriptures, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would impart in us your wisdom and your truth in our lives, that we would walk in your truth, not the truth of the world or what the world calls as truth. But Lord, I thank you that as we walk out of this, Lord, and we walk out of this service today, Lord, and I thank you that as we trust in you, God, as we step out in the leading of God and we begin to pour out our lives into the heavenly kingdom, Lord, into the heavenly account, Lord, that you would open up those windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that we cannot contain. Why? Because, Lord, you have never given up on your promises, and we know that you won't do it for us. So, Lord, we put our faith in you, and, Lord, we put our feet in action of our faith, and we trust in you as our provision as we renounce that spirit of mammon over our lives. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said amen. Well, hey, listen, before we leave today, church isn't out. I'll let you out in just a couple of minutes. Before we leave today, I want to do one more thing. I want to ask you a question. I want you to evaluate, look at your heart. See, the Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. It's not time to get up. It's not time to leave. I'll let you out in just a couple of minutes. I want you, it's so important that you get a hold of what I'm talking about today. God says, I want you to examine yourself from time to time. Look at your heart. Remember how I just said today, consider your ways. I want to ask you a question. The question's simple, but it's complex. You see, the question is this: if you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? It's a very simple question, but you see, it's complex in that nobody will know that answer except you and God, and you and God alone, not your wife, not your confidant, not your therapist, not your best friend. You and God will only know that answer. And the question is, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? We see, we recognize that life is fragile. We're all one accident. We're all one incident. We're all one epidemic away from our eternal destiny. The Bible is very clear that when we die, it's one of two places that we will go, heaven or hell. There's no in between. So the question is, when you die, will you go to heaven or will you go to hell? Well, how you answer that question has a lot to say about your place and your position with God. And I want to go over those answers with you today. You know, it's real easy to bury our heads in the sand and say, you know what, I've never felt hell, I've never experienced heaven, I've never seen them in person, and I just don't know if they exist, and so therefore I'm just kind of going to be undecided in that decision. Can I tell you something? The Bible tells us that heaven and hell is a real place. It's real enough for God to speak about it in his word, real enough for Jesus Christ to personally talk about it, real enough for the Bible to be preserved over thousands of years, and then listen to this, reconfirmed thousands of years later for its accuracy. Why? Because it's a very important topic and very important subject for God, and He doesn't want us to just bury our heads in the sand and hope it goes away. Your eternal life is coming your way. The question is, what's going to happen to you? Well, you might say, well, you know, I hope I go to heaven. I want to go to heaven. I think I'm going to go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in God's word does it say that you can hope, that you can think, that you can want, that you can desire, that you can have the most positive outlook on life? Nowhere in God's word does it say that you can wish your way into heaven, and that means that you're going to get into heaven. You can't find that in the word of God. Nowhere in God's word, listen to this, nowhere in God's word does it say that because your parents told you that you were a child, or as a child growing up, that you were a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you were baptized as a baby or because you went to Sunday school or catechism classes. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that when the census came knocking on your door, you marked Christian in the box. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself the title and label of Christian and that you've got a cross or crucifix around your neck or on your wall. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you sit in church on a somewhat regular basis, that means that you're going to get into heaven. You listen, the Bible tells us this. Jesus says it like this. He says, you're going to come and you're going to cast out demons and say, Lord, didn't we cast out demons in your name? And He'll say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Why? I know you not. You see, it's not about your title. It's not about how you look. It's not about what somebody's done to you or blown smoke or water or prayed a prayer over you in your life. Jesus says it's way more than that. I'm looking for more than just tradition. I'm looking more than just religion. Jesus says, I'm looking for something more than that. You see, well, but Pastor Luke, you know, I'm a good person. I've never done bad things. I try to do as good as I can to help my fellow human beings. And don't good people go to heaven? As a matter of fact, my friend Joe's on the front row. We had a conversation with a young lady, and she said it to us like this. She said, I figure if I be good and I do good, it's all good. Well, you know, that's a great way to live. That's a great thought in life. And it'll actually help out our fellow human being if we could live according to that. But did you know that according to God's word, that's not how you get into heaven? Your good works. As a matter of fact, God said it like this. He said that our good deeds, our good works are like filthy rags according to His righteousness. You see, there's nothing that you could do to earn it. There's nothing you could do to deserve it. There's nothing you could do to buy it. You can't work for it. The only thing you can do is receive it. Well, but you know, Pastor Luke, I have an understanding that there's a spirituality, or there's a force at the world or at works that's greater than me, and I try to keep an open mind, and it seems to me like everybody around the world, 98% of the people around the world believe that there's some spiritual force, and so I think that like we all kind of name it different thoughts, but we'll all get there together, and we'll all, whatever you want to call it, we'll all arrive at the same place. Can I tell you something? You're not coming back as a frog or a log or a dog. Can I tell you something? The idea that all roads lead to heaven and that we all call it different things, listen, that's not in the Bible. Jesus says it. I quoted it earlier. Jesus says He is the way, the truth, and the life. And He says no one goes to the Father except through Him. It doesn't matter about your spiritual awareness. God says, I want you to be connected to Me through Jesus Christ. Jesus says these words in John the 3rd chapter to a man by the name of Nicodemus, a religious man, a righteous man. Jesus says these words. In order to see the kingdom of God, He says, you must be born again. What does that mean to be born again? I don't understand that. Hollywood society's made a mockery out of that. And I think that that's like weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. But Jesus says from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it means the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. Jesus said to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, what is born of the flesh is flesh. What is born of the spirit is spirit. Listen, we were all born to a certain propensity. That propensity was sin. The Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody had to teach you how to lie. Nobody had to teach you how to cheat on that test. Nobody had to teach you how to steal when you needed it or when you wanted something. You figured that out all on your own. Why? Because there's an inherent evil on the inside of humanity that we continually try to fight with goodness. But you see, no matter how hard we try, we can't get rid of it. Why? Because Jesus says you must be born again, reborn into a new life, leaving that old behind. The Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but the same scripture says it like this, but the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift, you have a choice to accept it or to reject it, to take it or to leave it. It's your call. Jesus says these words in the book of Revelation to His church, speaking about an all or nothing relationship with God the Father. Jesus says it like this. He says, I'm knocking, or he says, I'm coming back. And when I come back, He says, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. And He was saying that to get your attention. He's saying, listen, can't do it on your own. What is lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means that you're doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. Occasional church attendance, token prayer. Jesus says, listen, if that's you, you're not going to make it. I love you enough. I respect you enough to tell you the truth today. If what we were talking about earlier today, those are the ideas and those are the thoughts that you've landed on, you're not going to make it. God forgive us in the American church that we have watered the message down because we have been more interested in the number of people in our chairs than the condition of the hearts. but I love you enough and I respect you enough today to tell you the truth, even if it offends you or it rubs you the wrong way. You're not going to make it your way. You're not going to make it because you hope so, because you want to, because you think so. You're not going to make it because you're good. You're not going to make it because you have some form of godliness. You're going to make it because you've given Jesus Christ all of your heart. You've given him all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship. In that same scripture, Jesus says it like this. He says, you think that you're wealthy. You think that you're rich. You think that you're clothed right. He says, you don't realize how naked and how destitute you are. He says, oh, I wish that you would come to me and buy gold refined for me. He says, oh, I wish that you would rely on me for your life. And then he concludes with this statement. He says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And he says, whoever opens that door, he says, I will come in and I will be with them and they will be with me and we will be together. The Spirit of God is knocking on the door of your heart right now saying, are you going to open the door? I'm calling you home. It's time to start doing life my way and not your way. It's time to start living to a higher way and not your ways. But it starts by opening the door to your heart. Well, if God wants me, he'll take me. Listen, God wanted you so bad, he gave you Jesus Christ to die on a cross for yours and my sin. And now in return, he wants your response. He wants your decision. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you before his Father. He says if you deny him, he'll deny you. The decision's yours and yours alone. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way. It's your choice. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you the opportunity to accept that gift today. Here's how we're going to do it. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. I'll go like this. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. Bang! And when I smack my hand together, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus. Pastor Luke, what you're talking about today, that's me. I feel like I need to commit my life to Jesus Christ. He's knocking on my heart, and I want to respond today. I want to make that response. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. And then you can put it right back down. Ah, I'm going to be embarrassed if I raise my hand. Listen, I'm not here to embarrass you. I'm here to build you. But it starts today by making that commitment for Jesus Christ. Can you do that today? Can you open your heart? Can you respond to the invitation of Jesus Christ? Who should do that? If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus. If that's you in just a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up. If you're not sure, you say, man, I don't know. I did this as a child or in a crusade once before, but I just don't know if I'm really right with God. Listen, the Bible tells us that the Spirit of God on the inside of us is God's seal of approval for us. God does not want you walking around life hoping or wondering or waiting or hoping that you might be right with him. God says, I've given you the Spirit of God on the inside of you to know without a shadow of a doubt your place with me. So if that's you and you're not sure today, listen, don't walk out of here without making sure. That's a gamble on your life you can't afford to make. If you've been living lukewarm, running from God instead of to God, listen, it's time for you to give your heart, to give your life to Jesus Christ. It starts today by making that decision. In just a moment, after you raise your hand, we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together, and you can be included in that prayer. What you're doing first is you're saying, I want to make a decision to follow Jesus, and I'll see your hand, and I'll acknowledge it. All across this auditorium, from the front to the back, side to side, wherever you're at, if you're out on the campus watching on the televisions or hear the sound of my voice or at home on the live stream, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time. Listen, you've had doctors and dentist appointments. It's a divine appointment now between you and God. And it's time for you to respond to the invitation of Jesus Christ calling you home, saying, come on, I have come that you would have life, Jesus said, and have it more abundantly. It starts by making that decision to follow Jesus with all of your heart, with all of your life. I'm going to count to three, wherever you're at, front row, back row, side to side, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time. Get ready. When I count to three, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and put it right back down. You ready? Here we go together. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six. I see you right up here in the front. Six wise people, where are you at? If that's you in this place today, raise your hands. Ushers are pointing over there. Seven, I see you right over there. I got you. Seven wise people, ushers are pointing over here. Give me a little bit of wave if that's you and you're raising your hand. Eight, I see you right over there. Nine, I see you back there. Ten, I see you back there in the red. 10 wise people, anybody else in this place? One, I see you very in the very back. I see you right over here. 11, 12, I think. 12 wise people. You say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. If that's you in this place today, come on, pop your hand up. Spirit of God's knocking on your heart. It's time to respond. If that's you in this place today, anybody else? I didn't embarrass them. I see you, my man. Anybody else in this place today? I didn't. It's your time to respond. I see that hand. About 15. I got you already. About 15 wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. This is your moment. I see you. Come on. Spirit of God speaking to you. It's time to respond. All right, my man. Anybody else? About 15 wise people. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for the 15. All right. So you said I want to do that. Listen, you and I know this. No decision without action is a decision at all. You can decide to do anything in life, but if you don't act upon that decision, nothing will ever happen. So you're deciding to give Jesus your heart. You're deciding to give Jesus your life. Now it's time to act upon that. And I said, we're going to pray a prayer of salvation. We're going to do that together. So here's what I'm going to do. If you raise your hand, or maybe you should have raised your hand. Maybe you're number 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. You should have raised your hand, but you didn't. I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible. If anything, you need a friend. In just a moment, we're all going to stand as we do. My buddy Elijah is going to sing a song. As he sings, I want you to grab your stuff. I want you to get out of your seat, get into the aisle, and come meet me here at the altar. If you came with somebody, look at them and say, come on, will you go with me? Or if they raise their hand, say, come on, you know what? I'll go with you. Let's go together. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair, come meet me up at this altar. We're going to change destinies together. You're going to pray a prayer of salvation, invite Jesus into your heart. Right now, your life is going to change. Come on, if that's you, come meet me up here, right now. If that's you, come on.
The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me.
If that's you, come on. Wherever you're at, from the back, from the family rooms. Well, it's like clockwork. You want to do it your way. Let me just tell you something. Raising your hand is not going to make a difference in your life as you walk out of this building. And I love you enough and I respect you enough to tell you the truth. Just because you raise your hand in a church service doesn't make you right with God. It comes by surrendering your heart, surrendering your life, and that's what we're going to do together. If you raise your hand and you're serious about this, God invited you and you responded, it's time for you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come meet me up here today. It's time to change your destiny now. So if that's you, come on, wherever you're at, get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come up here right now. Let's change destinies together. Sing it again, Elijah. Come on, if that's you, this is your moment.
We'll rise to Christ our King.
All right, well, hey, you guys came, and you got to be celebrated. Maybe you've made a lot of bad decisions, and maybe nobody's ever told you, but somebody's got to tell you today, good job. Good job. God's invited you, and you responded to God. I mean, good job. Here's what I want to do. I said we were going to pray a prayer of salvation. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on, I promise. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to invite Jesus Christ to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Lord and Savior? What does that mean? We don't know what that means. To be the leader of your life. You're going to invite him to come into your heart, come into your life. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information. Listen, we don't want you to leave here empty-handed. We want to get you hooked up with some information. As you walk out of here, you say, what do I do next? We're going to point you in the right direction with some free information, all right? Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want to connect you with somebody personally here at the church. Somebody that will meet with you. They'll buy you a cup of coffee, get you a soda or some french fries, teach you some things about the Word of God in our cafe right down there for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to your life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you in your whole new life. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Praise God.